For many of us, when we think of an engineer, we might think of a professional working on building bridges or designing structures, or maybe even working on a railway. But those jobs don't even scratch the surface of the fascinating work and discoveries that many engineers are involved with on a daily basis. This week's guest is an engineer with a PhD in materials engineering. Dr. André Phillion uses technology to expose weaknesses in everyday products made from wood and metals, for example, to assist in building more effective materials from the inside out. André, welcome today. Thank you for joining us here on UBC's Next Big Thing. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your background and what brought you here to the university.
Sure. I was born and raised in Thunder Bay in Northern Ontario. From there, I went to McMaster University. Then I went to graduate studies at UBC in Vancouver, spent a couple years in Switzerland, but decided that British Columbia is the place for me, and so it was time to come back. When I was a child, I guess you could say that it was perhaps just at the time when high-tech camping equipment was starting to become in vogue. Canvas tents were going to nylon tents. All the outdoor equipment was becoming technical and lightweight, and I was into all of that. A lot of this revolution in sporting equipment came from material science, from understanding new ideas about material properties and new methods of fabricating materials inexpensively enough so that they could be used for a wide market segment. And so my interest in lightening my pack so I could go camping has brought me to being interested in material science, which has brought me to where we are today, which is trying to understand how the process whereby we make materials affects the performance of that material. And so most of my research centers around how do we understand the properties of this phase change so that we can improve the performance of materials.
What are you hoping that you'll be able to discover through the research that you're doing?
Through my research, what I'm really interested in is trying to understand how the properties of engineering materials, so whether that be aluminum alloys for different applications, whether that be paper products, or whether that be components for fuel cells, how we can understand how the way that these materials are processed, how that links back to the properties or the performance of the material when it's used.
So what would be an example of something that you've worked on, maybe what the immediate use is for it and what you've done through your research that would help apply it in a different way or in a more effective way?
My research is really on understanding how the process evolves. And so my work is really in looking at processing, so that could be in the aluminum casting area as an example. You know, you have a mold, then you would pour liquid metal into this mold in the same way that you might pour water into an ice cube tray. And then as that metal goes from the liquid to the solid state, there are a variety of defects that can form, and that this can affect the finished product. And so my research is really in trying to understand how do these defects form. You know, what effect does the weather have, as an example. So in the area of aluminum castings, one of the big challenges is hydrogen porosity. And so small voids can form in metal. And then when this product is used, the presence of those voids, their size, their location, can lead to premature failure. So in my research group, what we're doing is we're using techniques that are based on 3D imaging or 3D material science, so that we can understand where these casting defects are located. And then we're coupling these experiments that we do to understand the presence of these defects with numerical models, so that you could change the way a component is cast to reduce the formation of these voids, so that ultimately the part will last longer, or ultimately you can reduce the amount of metal that that a component requires.
Have you been working with industry at all through your research, and if so, in what regard?
The project that has the largest industrial focus right now is a project that we have working with Canfor Pulp to understand the strength and structure of paper products. So there, what we're doing is we're trying to understand how the 3D structure of paper influences its performance. So what we're doing is we're combining these high resolution 3D imaging with some modeling of the paper strength to try to understand what limits the strength of paper and how different processes are going to affect the strength. You know, paper is a really interesting product. We use a lot of our wood supply to make paper-related products, and yet most of the wood fiber that we have that goes into paper making, it's very expensive, the BC product. Mm. And so it's often combined with hardwoods from other growing regions around the world to make composites of a hardwood and a softwood that have very high strength, which is what the British Columbia softwood provides, and the costs are lower, the hardwood is added as a filler material.
You were talking about 3D imaging and the ability to model from the 3D, or within the 3D imaging. So what does that look like? You actually, and it's microscopic, we're talking, you go well into the material.
So these are very tiny fibers, and through our experiments and our modeling, we're interested in understanding how these fibers collect or orient themselves together and how that might influence strength. One of the ways that you could visualize this is if you happen to go home this evening and you and your family have decided to make spaghetti for dinner. So if you look in the spaghetti pot after spaghetti is cooked, that's the types of images that one sees when one looks at paper in high resolution. So the scale is very different, but the structure is very similar.
André, talk about the different equipment that you use here on campus and the uniqueness of what you're doing here.
I run two laboratories here on campus. One laboratory is a laboratory for scanning electron microscopy. And so what we're doing there is we're essentially using electrons to look at images of a wide range of different materials at very high resolution. So there we can see objects up to, you know, 500, 200 nanometers in size, very, very high resolution. The scanning electron microscope works in a very similar way to the old CRT or the old heavy TVs, except that in a CRT TV, there was an electron gun which then displayed the image on a 24 or 37 inch screen TV. In the scanning electron microscope, it's the opposite. So we have the same type of electron gun that's generating electrons, but then we're focusing those electrons down onto a very small spot. And depending on how they react with that spot, one then sees an image. Now, the other equipment that I have on campus is a truly unique piece of equipment. It's called a 3D X-ray tomographic microscope. So that's a lot of big words, but essentially what it means is we're able to image in 3D by combining X-rays and computers. So the way this works is that one has a sample, and the sample rotates on a stage. A detector acquires X-ray radiographs in the same way as when you break your arm, you go to the hospital, they take a radiograph. The detector acquires many of those as the sample is rotating. And then a computer does lots of math to create a 3D image from that.
Wow. And from that image, you're able to investigate all those interesting components and to figure out what can be improved on.
That's right. So from that image, what we do is we try to understand how the structure that we generate or that we see in the image, how that then relates back to different material properties or different processing parameters. So one thing we're looking at right now is to try to understand what is the porosity in a component of a fuel cell called a gas diffusion layer. So what we're trying to look at the porosity in the gas diffusion layer of a proton exchange membrane fuel cell. In research, one would think of as a very basic quantity is what is the porosity of this product? And then when you go look at it, to define what is the porosity is very difficult. And then ultimately we'll take this further because 3D X-ray tomography machine, really it only provides data. And then the research is in what do you do with it. Mm-hmm. And to really make a contribution in this area, it's not only about being able to acquire these images that look great, but then you have to do things with them. So on the example of the fuel cell, we're interested there in understanding how does the gas, hydrogen or oxygen gas, move from one side of this layer to another side. In the example of the pulp and paper sector, what we're doing is we're using the 3D structure that we get from the tomography images, and then we're using that to directly create numerical models. Hmm. So in the old days, whatever the old days was, maybe 5 years ago.
Well, that's old.
In the old days, you would make a model. So you could assume that, the fibers were 3 millimeters in length by 30 microns in diameter, and that they had the shape of a toothpick. And then you would build those up and then do some sort of simulation. Because we have this tool for 3D imaging, we can now take the structure and then create the model directly from the actual 3D images. So that's something that you couldn't do before. And that's really where there's a lot of new insight to look at. Understanding how when you mix the softwood and hardwood fibers, where do the long softwood fibers end up as compared to the short hardwood fibers.
Well, it sounds like we're on the cutting edge of helping industry be able to come up with better products, to be able to do better things and more effective and safer types of work. So we appreciate you coming in and explaining to us the research you're doing. And I think I've learned a little bit today, and I can't wait. Actually, I've had a chance to visit some of your labs where you've got this great piece of equipment and fascinating stuff. Mm. André, thank you for coming in today.
Oh, well, thank you for inviting me.
And that wraps it up for this edition of UBC's Next Big Thing. I'm Rosemary Jean Thompson, and we'll see you next time.